Hello and welcome. My name is CS, and today I'm going to be introducing you a new turnkey solution for SRAM modeling that's now available in Keysight's Model Builder Program 2017. During our time together, we will discuss the concept of SRAM cell modeling, and I will highlight the major challenges of that process. Then I will show you a live demo. SRAM cells are the basic building blocks of computer memory and are widely used in microprocessors and ASICs. They are designed to operate at high speed while consuming low power. Foundries often use SRAM circuits for process verification and benchmarking. Now, what does a SRAM cell look like? To answer that, let's take a closer look at this schematic of a typical 6-transistor SRAM cell. As you can see, on the left is a simplified block diagram with cross-coupled inverters reinforcing the state of the memory cell. The memory information is stored at nodes CL and CH. Here's the next big question. What are the challenges involved in a typical SRAM modeling exercise? To begin with, the modeling software must be capable of handling multiple devices at the same time. This will allow you to tune parameters at both the SRAM level and the transistor level. Another challenge you will face stems from the fact that there are individual device IV curves and circuit figures of merit. As a result, the model needs to match major data in both categories. Device model parameters are adjusted for figures of merit, such as the static noise margin and critical read-write current. This means you will need to create and view both graphs at once, and iterate between the SRAM level and the single transistor level. Finally, a circuit designer may need to compare technology nodes between different foundries, and this is often done using SRAM cells. The challenge here is being able to compare those SRAM cells quickly and easily. Let's take a deeper look at the static noise margin, or SNM, that I previously mentioned. Suppose we sweep the voltage at CH and observe the voltage at CL, then we sweep the voltage at CL and observe the voltage at CH. After overlaying the voltage transfer characteristics of the two inverters, you can see that what we get is a butterfly curve. Hypothetically, let's just see that we have some external noise at CL and CH. How big do you think this noise can be before it threatens to change the state of the memory cell? Static noise margin captures this property and is commonly defined as the size of the largest square that can fit inside the butterfly curve's openings. Another very useful figure of merit is the critical read or write current. For the critical read current, we apply VDD to both bit lines and sweep the voltage at CH while observing the current at that node. A quick plot reveals the so-called N-curve, which is shown here in the middle. The critical read current is defined as the peak value on the N-curve. MBP displays this peak in real time as a function of model simulation. As you can see here on the right, we often plot this peak value as a function of VDD and temperature. Similarly, we get graphs for the critical write current, which is obtained from a slightly different bias condition as shown here. We apply VDD to one bit line and ground the other one. We then do a ICH-VCH sweep again and get the N curve. And the critical write is defined as the lowest value in the valley area on the N curve. At the bottom of this slide, I've referenced an IEEE paper. The paper describes how certain sections of an individual transistor DC IV curves influence different circuit figures of merit. As you see from the plot, the linear region on the IDVD curve of the pull-down device has the most influence on the critical read current. The region between ID high and ID set on the IDVD curve of the pass gate device has the most influence on the critical write current. By looking at these graphs at the same time and carefully tuning the related model parameters, you can achieve a very good fit to the critical currents without lots of model extraction iterations. Additionally, MBP enables us to perform a SRAM model comparison on all of the graphs. With that capability, modeling engineers can easily compare SRAM cells between process nodes and even foundries. Okay, let's go ahead and switch to a live demo of MBP. I will be using one of the demo projects included in the MBP 2017 release. We are going to exercise the following steps. Load a SRAM subcircuit model and data, view the butterfly and uncurve graphs, load each individual transistor IV data and two monoparameters, compare two SRAM models, and finally save the SRAM model back to a file. Alright, this is the MBP GUI. We now see a 2x2 graph with the butterfly curve on the top left and the uncurve for critical read current on the top right. Its VDD dependency graph is on the lower left and an additional IDVD graph from one of the transistors showing on the lower right. On those graphs, the symbols are measured data and the solid lines are the simulation data. At the bottom of MBP GUI, we have the SRAM subcircuit model where we can access all the parameters. For example, let's find the VTH0 from the pull-down device. While we tune it, the simulation curves update as well as the numbers on the graphs, such as the static noise margin and the peak value on the uncurve. Now let's start over and see how we can get those graphs. Please go to the menu, File, Project, Open. Pick up the sram.prg file from the example folder. The project file contains the SRAM subcircuit model, measurement data, and the definitions for static noise margin, etc. Come to the SRAM tab. The top table shows the available measurement data of various conditions. Let's pick the room temperature device where T equals to 25 degrees C and click on the View All Pages icon. All the graphs under this selected device are now shown in the browser. Next, let's load some measurement data for pull-up, pass-gate, and pull-down transistors. After we pick up all the data files, one by one, we shall see the data populated in MBP GUI shown as individual tabs. Now, switch to the default browser. We can go ahead to pick a few graphs of interest and display them together. Here, I'm going to bring the uncurve, critical read current versus VDD, and IDVD curves from pull-down and pull-up devices. Let's see which transistor has the most influence to SRAM's critical read current. In the model table, let's bring up the model parameter called delta from both pull-up and pull-down devices. MBP uses differently colored dots to tell which parameter from which device, and we can further sort them by device name. With the same tuning step, let's tune delta from the pull-down device. We see that the critical current changes significantly, whereas tuning it from the pull-up device barely has any effect on the critical read current. To better view the simulation change, we can take use of the double sim function in MBP, which allows the previous simulation to stay while watch the new simulation moving when we tune a parameter. Let's enable it from the simulation menu and zoom into the linear regions of the IDVD curves. We now have verified that a small change on the linear region on the IDVD curve of the pull-down device has the most influence to the critical read current at the SRAM level. Next, let's add another SRAM to compare them. Please go to Menu, File, Model, Add Model, and pick up the SRAM Example 2 model file under the demo folder. Once we've done the name mapping for this subcircuit model, we see both of them loaded in MBP's model panel. Let's quit double sim mode and hold Ctrl key to multi-select both of the models and click the compare icon here. We immediately see two sets of curves showing up on all graphs, one in solid line and another in dotted line. We can continue to tune model parameters from both models in comparison mode. Finally, let's drop the model comparison, remove one model, and save the tuned SRAM subcircuit model to the hard drive as a new model file, which has the same text format yet with updated model parameter values. This shall conclude my live demo. Here's the bottom line for you when it comes to SRAM cell modeling. With all of the new capabilities, the time it takes to perform your SRAM modeling is effectively reduced from days down to hours, and that can play a critical role in helping you achieve your time to market goals. If you'd like to try out some of those analyses, you can download a trial version of the latest MBP software using the links I've provided on this slide. Thanks for watching.